Good morning, good afternoon, everyone. Thank you for joining the session and thank you for being patient. I have already displayed the agenda to you earlier, so I'll do a quick introduction of Shakuntala, and then Shakuntala will proceed with her session. So most of us know Shakuntala very well, but still I thought I will talk a little bit about her. Shakuntala is born and brought up in Mumbai. She lives with her mother-in-law, her daughter, who's a homeopathic doctor, and her husband, Prasad, who's also a nature enthusiast and trekker. She is a chartered accountant. She was working with Bharat Petroleum and left that job 2 years back to have more time for herself. So she has completed BNHS ornithology course, and now she is completing her lead bio course along with Prasad. She loves walking in nature, jungles, and trekking. Of course, bird watching. According to me, she is a very thorough and detailed. During birding trips. I have seen her mentioning precise points about the birds while identifying them. Today, I'm hoping to delve into this knowledge of Shakuntala, and looking forward to share the excitement of birding with her. Over to you, Shakuntala. I request everyone to mute your devices.
Thank you, Francis, and thank you for giving me this opportunity, and thank you all for joining in. I'll share my PPT.
Yeah, we can see your PPT.
Yeah, thank you. So, excitement of birding is the topic for today. And excitement is actually enthusiasm and eagerness. So, enthusiasm is looking forward that you will get some joy out of it. And eagerness is the excitement with which, or the enthusiasm with which, you take up that particular activity. So if you want to see the excitement personified, you look at Raju sir whenever he is with us on the birding trips. So that kind of excitement, and I have seen it in many of my birding buddies. And birding is not only watching birds, of course, looking at their colors and watching their movements and seeing their flight is always very exciting, but there are many aspects of birding which come along with birding and really excite me. So when you say birding, we have a lot of hotspots, whether it is within your area, in your locality, or within Mumbai, or near Mumbai, or outside of Mumbai. And we always aspire that we should visit most of those birding places. Can everybody hear me?
Yes, Shakuntala, very well. Thank you.
Okay. So, but I think that for me, birding is not restricted only to hotspots. So, wherever I go, I go birding. So, I say birding anywhere. So, where all I go birding I'll give you a few examples of where all I go birding. Okay. So, is one place I went birding was my native place. I have been going actually to this place for the last 20 years, at least once in 2 years, but I have never birded. So once I joined and really seriously started taking up this journey into the world of birds, I started looking at opportunities. And when I went to my native place, I thought I should get up early in the morning. All birders know that, right? So I also got up early in the morning, and I was in only my backyard. And my backyard itself, I saw some 25 birds, and this brown-headed barbet is one of them. One more place is whenever I go on trips. So this is one of the trips. I went with my friends to Midbau. And this is actually a place around an hour and a half from Kankavli. By the way, Kokan is a very beautiful place. Anywhere you go in Kokan, you will find birds, right? So in this place, the beauty of this place was that it is a village. It's a well-developed village, but a small village. And every house is surrounded by trees. So along with me was my friends, Pratibha, Prakash, myself, Prasad. So all of us decided in the morning, let's go up in the terrace and see whether we can see some birds. And to our surprise, we saw so many birds, and including the gray-fronted green pigeon, the purple heron flying at eye level. And the advantage was that we were on the terrace. So you can understand from this photograph of black-necked woodpecker that we were actually at the tree level. So the excitement was of seeing the birds at tree level. When I go out with my friends for holidays, that is also one more occasion on which I see this, I don't lose opportunity to go birding. So this, I have gone to Diwar Island and we spotted the blue-faced Malkova. This is actually clicked by my friend Jinal. So, and many of the photographs in my presentation are by Prakash Mendel, my friend, and you will see them, how beautiful they are. So this particular trip I will talk about a little later because it's a story and I will take you through that. One more occasion I didn't miss to go birding was, took the opportunity to bird, was when me and my husband had arranged a cycling trip for him and our family members, his cousins and nephews. My daughter was also there, and they cycled from Bombay to Goa. So I joined them as a manager. So I was supposed to take care of the logistics, and that's why I had one vehicle with a driver with all the luggage and that, and keep a watch on the cyclist just in case they need something. But in that, I had a lot of opportunity to bird. So I could wait wherever I thought there was a habitat which I could see birds. I would halt the vehicle, get out with my binocs and camera and do birding. And one such bird that I saw was on the seashore, because this whole road is on the seashore. It is called the coastal route itself. So here I saw the Eurasian curlew, and this was somewhere around Murud. So that is between, you can say, Alibag and Harihareshwar. I don't lose opportunity to go birding even if when I go outside for some weddings. So I went to Nagpur for birding, and I took out one morning off and went birding to the Gorewada Lake. It's a beautiful lake. If this was in the middle of March, if I had gone there a little earlier, probably I would have seen the red-crested pochard. But I met a local birder there and requested him whether he can show me the place around, and he did. And this is my latest lifer, the rufous-fronted prenia. So excitement of birding, when I say lifer, is one is seeing the lifer, right? So seeing new birds is an excitement. So lifer is an excitement for me too. Experience where as I go in the jungle and experience the jungle, there are a lot of things about the birds, their behavior. And one of the, I can say, phenomena of this birding is hunting parties, okay? And this, I have put the hunting party of Dandeli specifically here, is because I saw some difference between these hunting parties and hunting parties I saw elsewhere. When I saw the hunting party was led by a drongo. And this I have seen in many places, that it is either led by a black drongo. So if I see a black drongo, I know there are, and it's early in the morning, I see that I expect that I will see lots of smaller birds. So I saw the black drongo. I was on alone. We were staying in a resort, and the owner said that you go in this place, you will see the birds in the resorts itself. And there I saw this hunting party in the actually the lower foliage. These were actually tawny scrubs, and I saw the orphan warbler, the brown cheeked falvetta over there. These pictures of orphan warbler and brown-cheeked falvetta I don't have because I was not photographing at that point of time. But this I have taken from the web, from the internet. Okay. The beauty of this hunting parties is that these are all these small birds which keep chirping and moving around and prancing around, foraging. And I don't know, I just get excited when I see so many birds of different kinds, and they're generally a mixed party. So there is not... I have the opportunity of seeing many different kinds of birds in these kind of hunting parties. Hunting party I have seen in Himalayas also, and it has its own charm. And these birds in the Himalayas are, what I've seen are, these are these small birds. They are around 10 centimeters or so, very small birds. So in the hunting parties, mostly I have seen the black-chinned yuhinas, or the yuhinas. So there will be the black-chinned striped, the, I don't remember the other name. Then you'll see the tits, which are, well, two of them, which I have shown here. That is the coal tit and the black-faced tit. This black-faced tit is very, very sweet. And some, I was lucky that in one place in Sattal, in the mixed hunting party, I found this fire-breasted flower pricker. Okay. So this is actually a parade of birds that you can see at one place. They just peek out from their wild foraging to just give you a look for some time, and then they vanish. They look at me and then they vanish. So that is very, very exciting. What I've seen in near Goa. I had gone to a place called Divar Island. So this was in the month of July 2018. So when I went, not 18, July 2019. So it is rainy season. And rainy season, I didn't expect any birds. But somehow I could not control my temptation to go to this island, because I had gone the earlier year and I'd loved this island. And somehow I had a feeling that this particular island will have birds. So I went into, there are two of my friends who are very interested in birding along with me. So all three of us set out. And in the morning around 8 o'clock, I went to this Divar Island. When I reached there, actually that island has a small hillock there. And on the hillock, there is a church. So we went to, in the pressings of the church was closed, and I expected to see some birds because there is a lot of forage there. But somehow there was no sound at all of birds. So we just kept walking here and then. There's a Ganpati temple below. So we went into that temple, and then suddenly this I saw one large kukushraik. I saw the large kukushraik, and my friend was trying to click a picture of it when it started drizzling. We just moved around that place, and then we moved on. We thought we will wait in a shed, and it poured. And we were thinking, where to go, what to do. But we said, let's wait at least till the rains recede. It kept pouring for 15-20 minutes. And after 15-20 minutes, it started drizzling. So we said, let's move out and see whether we can see something, or let's start moving backwards. Then when we came out, my friend suggested, let's go on the other side of the road. And by the time we reached that side of the road, the rains had stopped completely. And the experience that I had was so amazing. I saw the Nilgiri flower picker, three kinds of sunbirds, the spider hunter with nesting material, the large kukushraik, bulbuls. There was an array of birds. So when I felt, and this experience of rains for me, I'll tell you one more incidence of the rains. That experience that the rains, actually you can't see birds, is that day it just fell apart. And yes, you can see a lot of birds. We came ahead a little bit, we walked for 5 minutes. And in that place, we saw the leaf bird, this blue-faced Malkova. And when we were returning back, we saw the Indian peafowl. So it was beautiful. It was a nearly 37 species of birds, right? And nobody around, only three of us and the birds. So wonderful. One more experience of the birds is, I don't have a picture of that bird here, was when I had gone with my husband, with his friends, to one of his friends' native place. So we reached there in the morning, and it was not early morning. So it was around, by the time we reached there, it was around 10, 11 o'clock. So, and again, it was rains. So it was somewhere in the month of August. So it was again raining. So, but still my enthusiasm to, find birds doesn't go away. So when the rain stopped a little bit, I went into their terrace and was looking around. I found the water flasher there. And then I heard the sound of the gray I can't remember the name. And the Indian pitta, the gray cuckoo, gray-bellied cuckoo and the Indian pitta. I heard the sounds, didn't see them. But then when we saw, I saw, my husband said, there seems to be a dongo for us. And when I put my binocs on, it was the fork-tailed dongo cuckoo. That was the first time I saw it. And that was very exciting. So I had just seen it in pictures and then seeing it in actual was really, really beautiful. Another experience is of the when we had gone to Thattikad. So Thattikad is known for birding and it was a specific birding trip. When I went there, we reached there in the morning in the jungle and we were moving around for nearly around, I think, half an hour. No sound. The jungle was absolutely quiet. And I was just wondering whether we are going to see any birds or not. And moving around, after some time, the guide started saying, jungle shanthe. Jungle shanthe means no activity, means no chance of seeing any birds. So going around this place, I realized that maybe we have to return back for breakfast. We are not going to see any birds. So when I was... And suddenly this guide said, come here. There seems to be some activity. And what did we discover there? A family of Malabar Trogon. The male, the female and the juvenile all together. So the jungles have their own surprises and their own ways. They will reveal to me when they can reveal. Another experience that I have enjoyed is near water bodies in the jungles. So, all of you know the CC kitchen, right? That is at Goregaon. Somewhere in the first week of June, when the water in the jungle has all, you know, dried off, that was the time I was there. And the birds, I'd heard that the birds come there to drink water because there is small man-made water body. And what a surprise. I went there twice and I saw a parade of birds there. The Indian scimitar babbler, the black-necked monarch, the rufous woodpecker, puff-throated babbler, rufous-bellied babbler, and so many. And the jewel of that place is this oriental dwarf kingfisher. So this, and what excited me was about this kingfisher. Sorry, just give me a minute. So what excited me about this Oriental dwarf kingfisher was, I think it was its time to build its nest. So the nest it builds in a in mud, so in mud walls. So it had come clean itself, and I saw this Oriental dwarf kingfisher dipping in the water at least 15 to 20 times, cleaning itself. So such a colorful bird, and very exciting to see. So, excitement of birding is when I go on my birding trips, of course. But there is more excitement when I spot birds I don't expect to see in unusual places. And sometimes at some places, some unexpected birds. So, if you see, there is a red-whiskered bulbul here. So, you'll think that what is there so unusual about a red-whiskered bulbul. But can you believe I spotted this when I was on my way in a train from Mumbai to Kankavli, and we halted on a station in between, and this bulbul was eating on some creepers that had grown on the platform wall. one more experience of surprisingly finding a bird was when I was going on that Bombay Goa cycling trip. I halted at one place, and on the wire I found an oriental skylark. So I was just trying to take a pic of the oriental skylark and trying to observe, because I was a little confused whether it is oriental skylark or not. And suddenly there was some movement near my feet, and I saw this Malabar lark. I don't know whether this picture is clear, but this Malabar lark is trying, it is in its mating season, and it is trying to woo another lark, which was female lark, which was 2 feet away. So I was excited because I had experienced a part of the bird life. I had been, so one more experience of the bird life was when I went to Bhandup pumping station and my friends had spotted a zitting cysticola. So I was a little behind. They told me there's a zitting cysticola. So I was behind them. I was trying to locate it. And I saw a plain preenia, which was actually calling very frantically. I didn't understand why it was doing that, but I thought it's a normal routine. But then when I just stepped ahead, I saw 1 feet away from me on the floor was this little baby of its. And when you see the baby and you see the mother calling, and when I saw it, I was actually wondering whether this baby is, it's fallen down, or it's in the normal circumstances. And I was a little confused, but I kept looking at the mother calling and the baby. And while I was looking at the mother, after 5 minutes when I looked down, the baby had flown away. So in probability, the mother had succeeded in calling and the baby back to its nest. This is Pallas, and a beautiful plant and beautiful birds on that. What could be more exciting, right? So I had this occasion when I was traveling from Nagpur. I had gone to a fort called Ramtek, and that fort has a great historical significance. And I was traveling from me and my friend, only two of us were traveling from Ramtek to Nagpur. And on the way, it was 12:30 in the afternoon. So however, I wished that I could see birds, and it is pretty hot in Nagpur. It was at least 40 degrees or so. So I thought I had little chance of seeing birds at that time. But this flower was so tempting, so I kept looking at them. And at one spot, I saw something fluttering in. So I asked the driver to wait. And then on this plant, I saw the yellow-capped woodpecker. This is the chestnut-tailed starling. I saw the Brahmini starling and the purple sunbird. So beautiful birds and beautiful plants. So one more unexpected sighting was when I had gone to Goa, and we were going from Charao Island to Bichilim. And in the way, we saw some swamp hens and cormorants. So my friend wanted to click some photographs. So we waited there. And then there were some locals there who were fishing in the water. There was some water body over there. There was a stream passing by. So my friends, the locals said that all birds come here I forgot to tell you, this was around 5:30 in the evening. So the local people told us that there is birds come to roost here, and a lot of birds come here. So we decided that we will wait here for some time. So as we waited, there were flocks of egrets, cormorants, open bills. And then I saw the small birds coming in a flock. There were at least 200 of them. And they kept swaying here and there, and then they settled on this tree. And having a close look at them, I found that they were Malabar starlings. So I never expected to see this in this flock of starlings in this place, and it's very exciting for me. Okay, so birding in the Himalayas has its own charm, and different birds, but this. I'm not going to talk about actually the birding trip, but then again, the surprises that I found, which when I was not actually birding and I found birds. Okay? So this is a crested kingfisher. Okay. This bird, we were traveling to a place called Makkumatt. So this is around an hour's journey from Rudraprayag. So we had from Dehradun to Makkumatt on the way, this winding roads of the Himalayas with the cliff on one side, the valley on the other, and the river flowing down. So this is the route that we take. So we kept watching outside, and at one place we found this crested kingfisher sitting on a wire. But it was against light, none of us could get any pictures. So we decided to move, and it flew off by that time. So we decided to move off, but it was flying in the direction that we were moving. And when we came ahead, there was this small stream going below. And in the Himalayas, there is a small, there are many places, there are small bridges where there is only one-way traffic allowed. So we were on that bridge, and suddenly we saw this crested kingfisher sitting on the stone, on the rock below. Now, on that, there was no chance we can halt on that bridge. We had to move on. After the bridge finished, there was marketplace, no way we could halt our vehicle. So we kept moving ahead. And but nobody wanted to leave the chance of seeing that crested kingfisher again. So we parked the vehicle where we could. It was nearly a 5-minute drive. And imagine where birds can go in 5 minutes, right? So we all ran back. And for some time, we couldn't spot the kingfisher. But then we found it sitting on the rock. Unusual, because that was not a place we were trying to find. Neither it was surprising, because it was a place where we saw the bird. I mean, less chance. We never thought we would have a chance to see this bird there. So while on that trip in Makkumatt, and Chopta is around an hour's journey from Makkumatt. So we wanted to cover Makkumatt and Chopta. So we have some time in between. So we went to a place called Devriyathal. Now this Devriyathal is a trek of around 3 hours. And this tal is on the top of the hill. Very, very beautiful, very, very serene. There is snow there. And I found a missile thrush there also. And then, we had gone to see the tal. So no expectation of birding. But while we went, while going, the guide insisted that we go on horseback. While coming back, there was no way I was sitting on the horse. It's very painful to sit on a horse while coming down. So I told them I will walk down, and if required, I'll run down, but I will not sit on the horse. So as I was walking down, I had come around half distance down, and at this altitude, I saw this snow pigeons, a flock of snow pigeons flying by. So this was a flock of snow pigeons flying at eye level. Extremely exciting. We finished the trip, and of course, got a lot of lifers, that excitement. And then we were on our way back. And I never liked leaving the Himalayas. But we were on our way back. Yes?
I don't like disturbing you either. But since we are using the free app, so we have 3 minutes left. I will let you know when we'll stop. For everyone, when we stop, we'll close the meeting, and you join the same meeting again. With the same link, same username, same password. You can go on for another 2.5 minutes.
Okay. Thank you, Francis. Thanks. So this, I'll try to finish this slide before we break off. So we were on our way back, and there was some work going on. It had rained also. Rains have not left me during this. Each birding trip this year has been. This has been the year of rains. So there was rains. The roads were mucky. And suddenly on that road, my friend Madhavi said that, halt, there's a wall creeper there. And we all somehow found space, the driver found space to halt the vehicle. We got out the vehicle, and we on the vertical wall, we saw this wall creeper. The beauty of this wall creeper is when it closes its wing, you see only light gray and dark gray. And then when it opens its wing, you can see this beautiful reddish pink. And then this white spots here. This is beautifully captured by Prakash. This is Prakash's photo. And the excitement of seeing this bird was amazing, because it was end of our trip. We are not expecting to see birds, and then to see the birds. Then I saw this bird at two more places. One again on our way back, and then again when I was in Lat Panchar. And always seen this bird on vertical walls. It actually feeds on the insects in the walls. So I was talking about my trip to Makkumutt and back, and on the way again, coming ahead after spotting the wall creeper, then we came ahead and we were halting at one place called Narkota, where we have tea and breakfast. And while on our way, we had halted there, and because there is a small stream there, and then you know the chaiwala has throws away a little bit of food, so there are some birds which come there. A good opportunity to click birds. But I never expected to see a yellow-bellied fantail there. So we had seen black-chinned babbler there, then grey bushchat, and then some woodpecker. But while on my way back, I saw this yellow-bellied fantail. Very exciting. So one more experience of the Himalayas is when I had gone to Lat Panchar. And as I said, the rains haven't left. They have at least been there at least one day of the birding trip. So in Lat Panchar too, one day it rained very heavily. Now, all the other participants said that what to do. So the option was at least either sit at home. So we said that our guide suggested that there is one orchid farm around a 2 hours journey from Lat Panchar at a place called Mangpu. So they said, let's go there. So I was very disappointed. I said, let's wait. If the rains recede, we can see birds here itself. He said, no, there is a lot of opportunity on the way. Let's go. So we were on this way to Mangpu. It kept raining. It kept pouring for the first 1 hour of our journey, 1.5 hour of our journey, it was pouring. And then after a certain time, it started drizzling. And our guide said, halt the vehicle. The vehicle was halted. And then he said, look ahead. And what I saw was this tree. And with all these small birds. And despite the rain, all of us got down out of the vehicle. I put my binocs, took out my camera, and this was this beauty, the yellow-fronted green finch there. Okay. So a lot of surprises. Okay. Sometimes you see birds when you least expect it. I have seen birds when I least expect it. Okay. Now, coming to birds, I mean, flights of birds, everybody is excited to see two things about birds, flights, song and their beauty, right? Always exciting. That's what draws us to birds. So this, since I was on Lat Panchar, I'll start with this bird, the ruffous-necked hornbill. So the ruffous-necked hornbill is found only in Lat Panchar. There is some places in Northeast, but Lat Panchar is known for this ruffous-necked hornbill. And I was there, this was our target species there. So the first day itself, we set out. We saw this bird from the valley edge. We were on the road. We saw this bird, a pair of them flying by, but it was quite far away. Then we went a little down the valley, and there, I mean, we were getting down, so nobody was there. And then suddenly I saw these two birds flying at my eye level. And I had never seen a ruffous-necked hornbill at this distance, and that's why I couldn't identify. I was confused whether this is the great hornbill or the ruffous-necked hornbill or some other. So I asked the guide. He said, no, it's ruffous-necked hornbill. You'll find only ruffous-necked hornbills. So then when we went, it was a majestic flight, right? And then we decided we will go further down. So we, because there are some fruiting trees there. So we will wait there and we can see the bird come and settle in that. We waited for a very long time, and we started getting hungry. So we took out our breakfast and started eating it. And suddenly there was this whooshing sound. You know, I cannot explain it in words. You have to experience it to understand it, but I will try to tell you from my experience and my excitement. It's a whooshing sound when this the air passing through its wing. The male and the female came and sat in the tree in front of us. None of us could get really good pictures about it because we were all having breakfast. But I got a very good sighting of this bird along with the sound of its wings. So hornbills are, I mean, their flights are pretty in their own way. And another incident that I would like to tell you is when I went to Ganpatipure. So Ganpatipure is this temple at the base of near the sea. And behind it is a hillock. So when you come out of the temple, so we visited the temple and we were out of the temple and we were walking towards our hotel. And we were 3-4 friends of ours. Prasad was there with me. And we suddenly heard this sound. And when we turned our face, there were 5 hornbills flying one after the other. No camera, no binocs, but they were so close and so much at eye level that I enjoyed their flight. I have enjoyed the flight of this lesser flamingos at NRI Pond. I love to go and sit there. And then at high tide, this flocks and flocks of lesser flamingos with their beautiful colors just landing into the pond is amazing. This bird, I had been to Vijaydurg. This is a place in Konkan. It's a fort, it's a sea fort, and I was standing on the wall of the sea fort and there's sea all ahead. And then I saw this white-bellied seagull. So seeing the bird in its habitat was the joy. And then seeing its flight, because till the horizon, I could see this bird flying. So the excitement was all about seeing this bird fly at eye level. So I have been... there are some birding buddies of mine here, and I would like to thank Adil for this. This is Adil's photo from eBird. And we had been to Saswad to spot some quails and then the white-bellied minivet. And this trip, it was a wonderful trip organized by Adil. And of course, I have Francis to thank and Samir, who were along with us and made this trip very memorable. We had finished birding in this spot, and it was in the afternoon. It was very hot. And so we thought we will wait under the trees for some time and then move ahead to another spot. While we were waiting here, Adil and Samir thought they saw some movement. So they went to investigate it. And I think with their moving there, this bird got disturbed. And I had no idea what bird was. I just saw it flying by. And then Adil told me that this was the nightjar, Indian nightjar. So Indian nightjars till that time I had seen only either sitting or I had seen pictures of that, never seen them in flight. So the excitement was all about seeing this flight in bird in flight, this nocturnal bird in flight. Okay. So observing some behaviors like feeding, sleeping, beating the weather, bathing, and some of the mysteries, I will take you to the through this journey of mine, whatever I have observed while I was birding and whatever excited me. So I have some videos here, and the videos may not be transmitted. There may be a break in the videos, but I hope you can see a little bit in the picture form in that. Okay? So birds I have seen feeding, and the waders in the water, different ways of using their beaks, different ways of foraging. I have seen the birds in the foliage pecking. And flying and catching insects and all that. And I'm showing you one or two of my recordings of birds feeding. So this is the hoopoe. And if you can see it,
enable the audio as well. Go on the top, 3 dots.
Yeah, 1 minute. Yeah. I'll run it again. Can you hear it now, Francis?
Yeah, we can hear you. Thank you.
Okay. So what this bird does is that you see at this point of time, actually pecks into the ground and opens its beak. And then it picks up the insects or worms from the ground. So this was at Jorbid dumping ground. And this... See, you can see here the bird picking up the insects. So it's exciting to see how different birds have different feeding habits. So this is not a very clear picture. But this picture excited me because I saw why the bird is named that. This is a ruddy tungsten, and it is actually in this picture, it could capture the bird actually turning the stone to eat the invertebrates below it. So seeing the bird named actually being proved in its feeding behavior was exciting. So this is again from my trip to Makumut, and it is very exciting. As I said, you know, exciting going birding. So you bird in the Himalayas along the road, you go to some forests. There's one more place which is exciting to bird is in the village itself. I have walked through the villages in different Himalayas, and it has never disappointed me. I have seen multiple amounts of birds in this village environment. So this woodpecker we saw over there, now I have heard that woodpeckers actually peck, you know, they make holes in the bark and then they put small seeds in there, and then either eat the seeds or they eat the insects that form because of the seed rotting. This was the first time I actually saw. So I have seen the woodpeckers, you know, pecking and putting seeds inside, but this is the first time I saw. When we reached here, this woodpecker was drawing something out of the cavity of this tree. And when it came out, its face, there was this big walnut in its beak. Very exciting. So in the COVID situation, Francis reminds us every day of staying safe, maintaining hygiene, etc., etc. So birds do that too. And they bathe. And I have seen them bathing in the morning, and I'm seeing them bathing in the evening. So this is one place. I had been to the Biwa wetlands of Virar, and I think this is not the bathing, this is about feeding. So bathing will come a little later. So when the birds are feeding, they also snatch food from each other. So this, I didn't know this. I thought it happens only in raptors when they actually snatch away from herons and all that. But I saw this one scaly breasted munia actually snatching away a grass blade from another scaly breasted munia and eating it. So I hope you can see it here. See, here it is snatching away and eating it now. Okay, so this was an unusual experience for me. I still don't have an explanation for that. Maybe I need to ask somebody. But I was in Talchappar, and we had not gone into the sanctuary. We had gone to a place called Jaswantgarh Flats. And in that place, we saw a flock flying. And that flock was a mix of ruffs. You can see the ruffs here. I just made a bigger picture because it is, you can see it's a grassland. Okay, so this was ruffs and European starlings. Actually, the European starlings and the ruffs were flying together. It seemed like one flock. They all came and landed on this grassland, and the ruff is a wader, and it forages in the water. And I saw the ruff foraging here along with the European starlings on grass. I don't know why, but that was exciting. So, and this is one more activity of the bird. I don't know why it was doing what it was doing, but it was entering into this world of birds. So this is a sultan tit at Lat Panchar, and I saw it drumming into a tree. So I thought that it is actually making a cavity, but or foraging, so or feeding. But when I look closely, it is not feeding. Neither was it foraging, neither was it building a cavity, because it generally is known, this was at a height of around 5 meters, and it is known to build nests only 15 meters above the ground. So I'm still perplexed, still surprised, but good to know that I'm excited to see this different behavior of bird. So here I have seen a lot of birds feeding their little ones. It's amazing. It's exciting to see this. How the birds demand food from their mothers, and how the mothers make that effort to feed the birds. And here is a picture, this is a video from Bharatpur, where the painted stork is feeding these big babies of it. And they are demanding, just like the small babies demand, they are also babies. So, but it is amazing to see these big birds demanding food from their mother. We'll go through this video. This thing, the unique thing about this, what I observed was that it, the mother was not feeding the baby in its mouth, but was either on the ground, and then the babies were, I mean, the chicks were picking it up for eating. So, like us, these birds also are dealing with hot and cold. And I have these two observations, and it was amazing to see it. I had gone to Big One, and ahead of Big One, there was a scrub line. And I actually went there to see a courser, and this is what I found there. This is the Indian silverbill with their beaks open. And I was wondering what it is. I asked the guide, and he said that they are actually dealing with the heat by doing this. When I came back and I searched on Google, I found that panting, like dogs do, panting is one way the birds deal with the heat. And this was nearly 45 plus degrees. Then in an opposite to this was in Bharatpur, where it was pretty cold, around 10 degrees. And this Brahmini starling was all fluffed up. So this was its way of dealing with the cold, fluffing up the wings and letting the air in so that the heat stays within the body, is retained in the body, and it is insulated. So this is about bathing, what I was mentioning earlier. So we'll see this video. So this is in the water, right? So these are Muniyas bathing. So this is, when I see this, I feel I have entered the world of birds. They are showing me a part of their world. I have seen a similar behavior at when we went to Makkumat, and we are returning in the evening. And there was a small water puddle on the side of the road. And I saw tits bathing in that. And our guide was telling it, I don't know whether he was actually fooling me, but he said that, do you think you are the only one who bathes? These birds bathe before going to bed. I don't know that's true, but I think should be, because he has an experienced guy. And this is a lockdown video. Like birds bathe in the water. There is something my friend told me, but I didn't know when I actually filmed this, but my friend told me that it is called leaf bathing. So it is actually when there are some dew on the plants, or when suppose you're watering the plant. So here somebody had watered the plants, and this common tailor bird was leaf bathing on it. Or after the rain, sometimes also it is observed. So let's have a look at this video of leaf bathing. It actually bends its neck, touches its belly, and then wets itself. Beautiful insight. Another way the birds keep themselves clean, or this thing I have seen, is by mud bathing. I saw mud bathing in of Malabar Tamil in Dandeli. So I've seen them actually prancing around and in the mud, and then, you know, cleaning themselves up. So this is not from, I don't have a picture of that, but this is my picture from Kenya. This is a yellow-billed hornbill, and it was also mud bathing. So different kinds of bathing behavior of birds. And birds sleep too. And I had seen that birds, generally when they sleep, they put their beaks in their feathers. The reason is that the beak is an exposed area. There are no feathers on it. And that's why it puts its beak in its feathers, and it to cover it with the feathers so that they don't lose body heat. Another reason why the birds do that is I read it that it is because they want to rest their neck on their shoulders. So this I have seen many times, but this is from Bordi Beach, and these are Eurasian curlews. So seeing this Eurasian curlews with their big beaks tucking into their feathers was very exciting.
How high can a summer go there?
Okay. This is one more mystery I have. I don't know. I don't know what is the reason. And this video is it's very camouflaged. So I don't know whether all of you will be able to see it. But I'll play it twice. This is when I was in Thattekad, and there were this Sri Lankan frog moths. I saw a pair of Sri Lankan frog moths, and they were sitting on this twig. There was a light wind blowing, but it was not strong. The twig on which they were sitting, or the branch, small branch they were sitting, was not moving. But you can see in this video, this two birds were swaying in unison. I didn't understand why, but it was beautiful to watch. So let's see. So I'll play this is the pair of Sri Lankan frog moth. I'll play it once again. Can you see it safe swing? I hope you can and enjoy that.
Because of the jerks, right? So it doesn't show.
Yeah.
We come. It's coming in frame.
Okay. Okay. Yeah. Okay. Okay. Fine. So this is limitation of technology. So I'll go ahead. So like that, when I'm birding, I have found a lot of different behaviors. You understand the reason, some you don't. So this is one more where this is not what you see the picture. This is again Prakash picture, and this you see the Baya weaver. And so everybody knows about the nest of the Baya weaver, and it is in breeding plumage. My experience was not of the Baya weaver when it was in breeding. It was in non-breeding plumage. And I had gone to Bandup pumping station. We were returning from Mulund, and me and Prasad, we thought we should, we had a chance. So let's go into the Bandup pumping station and have a look. So we drove in, and then we were moving around. We had just finished our birding and on our way to return. And I saw some two, three people looking at some birds, and I found that it was a flock of Baya weavers in non-breeding plumage. That was not a breeding season. So they were in non-breeding plumage, all of them sitting on the tops of, that's how they normally do. So the, sitting on the top of that grass. Now, I kept watching them. I was just observing because the light was fading, and I was not very sure whether this is a Baya weaver. So I kept looking at the birds. And then suddenly, like you clap your hands, all these birds went to the ground. I am still to understand. I tried to find out, but could not find out whether it was a sight, because it was as if when somebody had said 1, 2, 3, you know, start a race and all had run. That way, 1, 2, 3, all the birds were to the ground. Not a single bird on the grass blades.
Like ringa roses all fell down.
Yeah. So I think that it could be two reasons. One was that it was roosting time. I'm not very sure whether they roost on the ground. Second was they had seen some predator, and that's why they had given some indication and all of them had come to the ground. I have no idea, but that was beautiful. So this is one more experience in the world of birds. Though we don't understand what it is, it's beautiful to watch. So coming to the birds, I love the songs of the birds, and I like hearing them. It's a long way till I can really identify with the calls or the songs. But this is one call. I had gone to Ganpatipure, and me and Prasad, we were walking on the road, and this pair of puff-throated bubbler kept, you know, flying from one side of the road to another side of the road, and it was their breeding season, and then I could hear their call. So I will play it for you. This bird gave me the opportunity to record this call, and exciting. Okay. So this you may not be able to see the bird. It's very blur, but this is the oriental magpie robin. And this is my recording in lockdown, window birding, the terrace birding. So oriental magpie robin I have seen has a repertoire of songs. Sometimes it confuses us. And this is one of the songs that confused me. So I heard it one more time later when it sung this song, but it is very rare. So I will play it for you. So you will see it whistles and then there is a chup chup. So we'll go through this sound. So this is songs, both the birds that I show were songs. So there are very peculiar calls of birds also. And I have seen that birds, when they call, generally their throats expand and contract. I saw this scimitar babbler calling, and while calling, it actually moves its whole body. So let's see that. Hope you have been able to see it and enjoy it. One more bird I saw calling, and why it excited me was that this is a crater spotted eagle at Bharatpur. It was very hazy, cloudy in Bharatpur. So you may not be able to see the bird very clearly, but I am hopeful you'll hear the call. But this bird I have generally seen flying. I have seen it perched, but never perched in this manner with its wings down. And now I'll play the call for you. So what is exciting is how it calls and looks up into the sky. I don't know for whom it was searching, but it was exciting to see this. This is again lockdown, and this coppersmith barbet, all of us see in the city. It's a city bird, beautiful, colorful. What behavior I observed of it was it calls, and I've seen it calling many times. But this little bird, it picked up a larvae from a tree nearby, came and sat on this branch, and with the larvae in its mouth, it was calling out. Let's hear it. I think it is its mating season, so it was trying to lure another female. So I hope you can see that it has something in its mouth. So I have my bird visits, observing birds, watching birds, watching in all respects their behaviors. Actually, they're letting us or letting me into their life, allowing me to watch them. And then while doing this, I try to capture some pictures. I'm not a great birder, so most of the pictures in this thing are of Prakash Mendel. But these are my pictures. So sometimes I manage to get some good pictures, and that is exciting when you come to visit and then you go through that. It brings back the memories of the birding trip, and then also the happiness of being able to capture the bird as it looks in the field. So I'll show you some of my photographs of which I think are good. So this is the gray-breasted crinia. The lesser white throat. Now, why I like this bird this picture is because this bird never stays in one place for more than a second. So I am very happy with this picture. Of course, this is beautiful crimson sunbird at Sattal. Scaly breasted minnow, because I could actually capture the feature of its body that has given its name, the scaly breast. Of course, the flamingos with its pink color. Wings and the juveniles behind it. And there's a different form of capturing raptors. And this is Lagar falcon from Talchappar. This is from, I like this picture because it gives differing shapes and size of the picture. It may not be indicative because they are flying at different heights, but there are at least four raptors in this picture, and that's what is excites me. This is the Egyptian vulture, the Himalayan vulture, the vulture. And what I love most and I get excited about is IDing birds. So I'll give you just one example. This is a picture of my friend Rupesh Balsara. And we were in Lakpanchar. And as I said, birding in the villages, is you can find a lot of birds. And we were going in this village. This thing said that, let's go in the village. We will find some birds. Not exactly evening, just around 4 o'clock or so. So we were in the village. And suddenly Rupesh said, I can see a different bird. And he ran and he clicked this picture. And we all could, nobody could get such a good picture. This is the best picture of the lot. And when we saw this bird, nobody could identify this bird. So when we came, the excitement was to go back and identify this bird. So the moment we came back to our rooms, we identified this and identified it as eyebrow thrush. But somehow something was ticking in my mind saying this is not eyebrow thrush. So after some days, I started looking into these thrushes again. And then I found that this bird has got gray flanks and not orange flanks. So eyebrow thrush is expected to have orange flanks. It has orange flanks, expected to humans it has. But only this wing bar is something I was not very sure, because whether a gray thrush of the first winter has this wing bars, the eyebrow thrush first winter has the wing bars. So what I did was I tried to find out something more, looked into the field guides and everything. And I was nearly convinced it's a gray-sided thrush. I'll come to the excitement later. So what I did was I put it in the bird ID group where there are experts, and they confirmed this is a gray-sided thrush. Now I'll tell you the excitement with behind this. In eBird, in the state of West Bengal, Lakpanchar is in northwest Bengal, in the city, in the province of, in the district of Darjeeling. So this bird, after 1995, this is the first time that it has been recorded in West Bengal state. So the of course there's excitement of sort of sighting a rare bird, a lifer, and then being able to identify it. Okay. So while into the journey of birds, so many other things. We met Mr. Sanjay Monga at NRI Pond, and he said that when you see birds, you will see a lot of things, and that's very true. So as I was birding, I saw a lot of butterflies, a lot of trees, a lot of insects, and so these are some of the insects. That was butterflies. This summer. So this, if you see this colorful insect, I was really excited to see this insect. I'll try to zoom it. Here. So this is, see the pattern on the wings and all that. And I had not seen this insect before. I've seen this in the Himalayas. And then I asked them, locally it is called Kanchinani. Beautiful name. And then coming on names, so other things that excite you on a birding trip is also knowing the local, the flavor of things. So when you go on an actual birding trip at hotspots, so whether it is Kerala, West Bengal, or it is Rajasthan, you get to eat the delicacies there, and then you get to know a little bit of their language. So I have made a video on the Nepali names, because the Lakpanchar is occupied mostly by Nepali. So the Nepali names, very interesting to get to know the Nepali names of birds, what they call birds, which generally comes from the behavior or habitat. And of course, my birding buddies. So it's always exciting to be with all my birding buddies. And my BNHS, Coastmates have, and my friends now have given me beautiful company during this journey of birds. And sometimes you see something which is very unusual on a birding trip, but you see something unusual. And this is one wild horses that I saw at Jaswankar flats in Talchappar. So sometimes you can see different things about nature. Birding, but there, wild birding also. And so this brings me to the end of my webinar. And I would, at this last side is, you know, this is how birding makes me feel. And this small video conveys what birding makes me feel. Yeah, okay. So the end of the day of birding, and this serene waters, and you know, so what this actually video covers a lot of things that I want to say about birding is that serene, it gives you a chance to experience something like this, or it gave me a chance to experience something like this. And also, you know, different sounds of nature, not only birds, but different sounds of nature in the company of friends, and beautiful. And it's beautiful. So I'll just play this video. Okay, so this was actually from then we had gone to Saswad. So this is thanks to Adil again, and that brings me to the end of my presentation. Thank you, Francis, so much. You made me go through my last 1.5 years journey, and thank you all for joining in. I hope you had a nice time.
Indeed, Francis. Indeed, Shakuntala, we had a very good time. In fact, the last slide was even better. It gave us a serene way of ending. That's how we end our birding trips as well. What a nice way. I remember we sat there in that place for more than half an hour, I think.
Yes.
Soaking in the whole atmosphere.
Yeah, it was so quiet, silent, and beautiful with the croaking of the frogs.
Correct. Yeah. I open the floor for questions. You can unmute your audios and ask questions, ask or talk, discuss anything. Or if you cannot, then please type your question. I will read it out for you. Radhika, I would request you to explain that Baya, we were all fell down kind of scenario. You mentioned it in the chat earlier.
Yeah, Radhika.
Hi, it is not the Baya weaver phenomenon, it is the frog mouths, Sri Lankan frog mouths, which were swaying in unison. I had been to Tattekad with Adesh, and what I was saying is they mimic the movements of the leaves swaying in the wind. So it is one
Okay, thank you, Radhika. Nice. Yeah, very thanks, Radhika.
I very enjoyable session. It's actually as if I have been to all these places already.
thank you, Radhika.
Yeah.
Anybody wants to say anything? I mean, Shakuntala, you can open chat and see what people are typing as well. Definitely, I think many of the birds which you showed are lifers. I have never seen them myself. So definitely, I want to go.
Yeah.
Avadh, Vanita, you want to say something?
Last hearing everything, Shakuntalaji. Okay, Avadh, you go ahead.
No, you go ahead, Vanita. We said same thing at the same time.
But I didn't hear you, so you'll have to say it again.
Maybe after you continue.
Okay. Yeah, like Radhika asked Shakuntalaji, we would like to know how you got into it, how you started, like, you know, how you got interested in birding.
Actually, I had I had been on my honeymoon to Kana. So both me and my husband, being nature lovers, we decided we'll go there. And we were going into the jungles every day. And somehow people over there were envious of us, because wherever we went, the tiger we could spot. So, and we had a very small guide with us. His name was Jagdish, I still remember. And this guy was actually, his father was a forest officer and his grandfather was a Mahout. So he was he had grown in the jungle. So he would take us to various places. And then we told him, we don't only want to see tigers, we want to see the jungle. So then he took us to various different places. We experienced the jungle very well and different animals. Then on the last day, he said, we will not go into the jungle. I will take you birding today. While we were traveling in the jungle also, he showed us birds. But he said, we will specifically go for birding. And that is when I was amazed to see so many birds in a span of an hour and a half. I must have at least seen 30, 35 birds. And that was, I thought that's, and I thoroughly enjoyed it. And that was what initiated me into birding. And then I kept birding, but I seriously didn't do it because I was working. So it was not seriously. So whenever we went out, I made it a point to just watch birds. Yeah. And then when I resigned around 2 years back, I took this interest of mine seriously and have been birding since.
Abad, you had the same question, right? Or anything different?
No, I was saying that it was very good presentation and we could feel Sagutla's excitement when she was talking to us.
Thank you, Abad.
Waiting for going on another trip with Bajet.
I can't hear you. Your voice is breaking, Abad.
Can't wait to go on other trips with you, Sakuntala ji.
Yes, welcome. We are all, I think all of us are waiting to go birding after this lockdown is
away. Correct. Yeah. And I don't know, you would not have seen, chats earlier sessions. So a lot of my lifers are because of you, because you always look at the photos after you come back from birding and say that, you know, this bird was different, and then you will ID it and then you will send it to all of us.
Yeah.
Thank you so much, Sakuntala ji.
Yeah, I love doing that.
That is what I admire about you as well. You mentioned about that bird you saw in Latpanjar, West Bengal, reciting of that bird. Like, that is absolutely, I don't do it. And, you know, great that you are doing it. And Prakash, thank you very much for sharing your photographs with us. I know you're on mute, but you are a good photographer. And Sakuntala, who said you are not a photographer? The last few pictures you showed were excellent, excellent pictures.
Yeah, Ravi once told me, when you take 100 bad photographs, you'll get one good photograph.
All right. Anybody else has anything to say? Ask. If not, first of all, I would like to thank all of you for joining this session. Nice to have friends back and people with same interest back. There are not many people joining today, but definitely a lot of people who are more interested have joined. That is good thing. Sakuntala, thank you very much for making this happen. I know I was after you for this and you said, no, kaisa hoga, kya hoga. But then you made it. You definitely made it so enjoyable to all of us. And thank you for that.
Thank you.
And don't forget.
Thank you, friends, for joining.